Hi, I'm Kumi Taguchi. Tonight on Insight, computer chips in our brains, those embracing it and why some are stepping away. How did you feel about having a device implanted in your brain?
It was scary.
It could be extremely traumatic.
What do you have that for?
I have OCD.
Well, I felt like I was 30 again.
Oh no, I can't function without it.
How does deep brain stimulation actually work?
Well, we wish we knew.
What attracted you to being part of the bionic eye trial?
I suppose it does go back to my love of science fiction.
It's hard to describe what it felt like the first time we made it work. I still get excited when I see things happen on the screen. I just sent that thought to my wife using my brain-computer interface. Hopefully she'll get the message and come and join me. Hopefully. My name is Philip O'Keefe. I live in Victoria in a small town called Greendale. In May of 2015, I was diagnosed with motor neurone disease. The variant of motor neurone disease that I have affects my upper body. One of the first things that I lost was my fine motor skills. The ability to hold a pen, type on a keyboard, tap on a phone is very, very limited. Communication to the outside world is disappearing. The device inside my head is a first generation prototype. This is still in its infancy.
Whilst he's trapped inside his body, he can contact me when I'm walking around the property. He can do our internet banking. He can tweet his friends.
And all that just by using my thoughts and the technology involved. There was nothing I couldn't do if I set my mind to it.
We were awestruck. We thought it was AI and, you know, something out of Star Trek, and that we were the only house in the whole world, really, that had this technology.
I've been able to tweet messages and get responses back from them and reply back to those responses. It's amazing, truly amazing. When you get sick or injured and your world shrinks, that's really hard. All those things that are so routine, you lose. My hope is that this gets developed to the point where people can regain their independence.
Thank you so much for being here. Nick, you're a biomedical engineer and part of the team which created that device implanted in Philip's brain. You've brought it with you. Could we take a look?
So it's called a stentroid, and it's a small device that that is inserted through a small puncture in the neck. And without open brain surgery, it is delivered to the top of the brain, the motor cortex. Mm. Now, everyone's very similar in terms of where their brain is and where it's mapped. For Phil, and the way he's able to control this technology is we pick up these signals when he's trying to perform a movement, when he's thinking about clenching a fist, even though he can't do it, when he's thinking about moving his leg. We can pick up these activity and use it as a way to perform a switch and let him communicate with digital technology like computers.
Now, this is what's known as a brain-computer interface, or BCI. So that allows, basically, Philip to think, it's like clicking a mouse, basically, and a command that's been sent from that, from his thoughts to that device.
Yeah, that's exactly right. We're picking up his intentional thoughts and we're translating those into a way that can be used by external equipment, such as computers, as switches or clicks to control the technology.
This is in clinical trials now, and so far four patients have had the implant. How long does it take to actually work?
Certainly, you know, as we as engineers and researchers are getting better, the time is getting a lot faster. The first participant, it took him about 20 to 30 days between being implanted and being able to perform this click. Mm. The second participant in about a week, and the second and third, like Phil, they could do it the same day. We're learning as we go, and certainly, you know, gentlemen like Phil are just incredible humans, and certainly thank him and his families for being involved.
Scott, you're a fan of sci-fi and also one of the first Australians implanted with a bionic eye. Is that a coincidence?
it's not necessarily a coincidence, but it's a bit of a shame as well, because I asked for a laser to destroy my enemies as well, but they just wouldn't do it.
So you could be like the Terminator with the red eye.
Exactly.
They wouldn't do it, but look, you've been living with a genetic eye condition called retinitis pigmentosa since you were a child. What has that meant for your vision, what you can see?
Well, I had some usable vision from birth up until about the age of 15, being able to still see a television or read very large print if I was, you know, a foot away from the screen or so. Yeah. But as time went on, the condition deteriorated, and when I was 21 years old, I was declared totally blind.
What attracted you to being part of the Bionic Eye trial?
I suppose it does go back to my love of science fiction. When I was around about 10 years old, I was getting regular eye exams at the Royal Victorian Eye and Ear Hospital. And my specialist at the time said to me that, you know, who knows, sometime in the future they might be able to develop something that may help you to see in some sort of functional way. Would you like to be a part of that sort of work? And I said, absolutely, sign me up.
5 years ago, you were implanted with a bionic eye. What was it like the first time you actually switched it on?
Activation day, it's seriously one of the days I will never forget for the rest of my days. It was just absolutely extraordinary. Sitting in the lab with the team around, and as they were running a charge through the system to see if I was able to pick anything up, I was just sitting there saying, no, nothing yet, no, nothing yet. And then all of a sudden I stopped for about 3 seconds, huge grin comes across my face, and I just said, ladies and gentlemen, we have proof of concept.
Wow. You could see something.
Yeah.
What just could you see?
It's translated to me as a little burst of light known as a phosphene. Mm. And the phosphenes are of different intensities and durations based on what image or, you know, thing I'm looking at, whether there's a light on in a room, something on a table, or even something as simple as my hand in front of my face. Mm. That's how I experience it. So it isn't sight as people would you know, usually define it. Mm. But for me, it's the first thing I've seen, especially out of my right eye, coming up 22 years now.
So what does this mean for your day-to-day life? What can you do with this?
I'm able to tell you when a door's open in a room, if I need to find where a source of light is, I can tell you where it is. If I'm looking for something on a table, I can scan across with the device and it will tell me where things are. And then I may be able to figure out what they are just from the phosphenes that are showing off in the array. Mm.
Penny, you're an ophthalmologist and you lead the team that's developing the bionic eye. How does it help Scott to regain some of his vision?
There have been a number of groups around the world developing this type of technology, but we were keen to develop a straightforward surgical access and a straightforward device that would be stable in position. So we place it within what we call the suprachoroidal space, a potential space beneath the retina. So we do an operation to place an electrode array beneath the retina, and that has an external receiver stimulator that is on the side of the head there.
And the glasses, is that like sort of having a camera?
Mm-hmm. Yep, you can see the camera, which Scott is pointing to there on the on the side of the glasses. And the glass at the camera captures the images and then transmits that down to the vision processing unit. Wow. The vision processing unit then translates those images into electrical stimulation, which then passes through and back to the device beneath the retina, using the residual tissue within the retina to go back via the optic nerve to the brain, to the occipital cortex, the part of the brain that we use for vision.
How did you know whether it would work, Penny?
Well, actually, at a conference prior to us doing a prototype trial, a colleague from Germany, I was having a glass of wine with him in the bar after the conference, and he said, you know your approach will never work. And I said, well, if we thought that, then, you know, we wouldn't be putting all this time and effort into this.
Is it risky not knowing the outcome of something, just going ahead with it and thinking, I think this is going to be good?
Yes, but there was a lot of preparatory work prior to us implanting the first patient, and we had quite a lot of bench and animal work information to believe that the devices would work.
Mm. Peter, you're a pioneer in implanting stimulation technology in patients' brains. How risky is it to put a foreign body into someone's brain?
Well, we've got a team, so there's a lot of people who have worked the patients up before we get there. So there's a neurosurgeon, I'm the neurology guy, and we have a whole bunch of people. Where we put this in the big relative sphere of things, it's a tiny, probably a couple of full stop size area that we get to, so it's a tiny hole through, and we've learnt over many years now, based on other people's experience and shared, how to get there safely. So the risk is actually very low.
How does deep brain stimulation actually work?
Oh, we wish we knew. It's basically quite complex, but essentially you're outpacing the cells in different parts of the brain. You're basically going into the brain with these tiny electrodes and they're outpacing it. There are different nodes in the brain and there's different ways of doing it, and you just dampen down the bad guys and let the information through.
What interests you about working in this space?
It's the brain, you know. It's the brain. And when I went over to Oxford, I met a fellow over there who was also in this position, and he said, look, nobody wants to work with me. Would you be interested? And I said, sure, I'm an Australian. I'll have a crack at anything, you know, virtually. And it went from there. We were able to see people who were disabled in many ways for 15-odd years on the table go snap. So the opportunity to contribute to the science, the fundamental understanding, plus change people's lives, you can't walk away from that, particularly when people have been struggling for a long time and you see it like that.
Fascinating. Clive, you're one of Peter's patients and you were diagnosed with Parkinson's in 2007. How was the disease affecting the things you loved in life before you had the surgery?
The effect was terrible. It starts off with a minor tremor in your left hand and it progressively goes on from there. Your hands are shaking and trembling. Your whole life is affected by the condition. And then there's, besides the physical aspect, there's the psychological aspect, misery. And by the time I reached the point of going for deep brain surgery, I was going to step in front of a bus.
Yeah.
Because that's how it felt. Not only you, but your family, everybody around you. It's awful.
Mm. When the idea of having deep brain stimulation came up, what were your initial thoughts?
Well, I decided way before that I wasn't going to let any crazy neuroscientist stick wires into my brain. But it got to the point where it was a no-brainer, to be honest. I couldn't function anymore. My hands were tremorous all day long, so I had to make a choice. And thank God I did the right thing.
You got the implant in 2018. How soon afterwards did you notice a difference?
Instantaneously.
Really?
Actually, while you're in the surgery, your hands from shaking before.
Wow. What was the adjustment to your new self like after the operation?
Well, I felt like I was 30 again. I went back to doing all the things that I'd done before. It was a bit of a shock to the family because they had got accustomed to me over a period of 11 years getting progressively worse. So it was like waking up in the one morning and your dad is dying and now he's alive again.
Mm. Yeah. Peter, what else can this technology be used to treat?
The technology can be used to treat many other conditions rather than movement problems. In fact, Parkinson's is more than a movement disorder. It's often, I don't think it captures it properly. And with the Parkinson's people, you then started to see other things change. The things that we look at now are central tremor, which is a tremor that with action, dystonia. We've used it for obsessive compulsive disorder and have published in good solid journals with that. We're embarking upon an anorexia trial now. Tourette's, people who have difficulty walking, although the mechanics are there, they can't get the messages through. And many other things, phantom limb pain, people who haven't got an arm but have got pain there for whatever reason. If they had trauma, we can settle that.
Mm. Nanette, you're another of Peter's deep brain stimulation patients. What do you have that for?
I have OCD.
When did you first discover you had obsessive compulsive disorder known as OCD?
It started when I was about five. Walking home from school, I would always turn around and look to make sure nobody was following me, then take another step, two steps, then having to repeat it again, and take another, like, one step, two steps. And it just started building up from there.
How did the OCD affect you over time?
I got to the point where it was just easier to sit and watch TV. That way I don't have to touch anything or move anything or just check that something is right, that it's there, that it's facing the right way. It was just easier to just sit there and not do anything, except for the TV channels, because I had to keep flipping back and forth between one channel and another.
You were diagnosed with OCD when you were 19. You're now 52. Did anything ever help?
No. I've been on meds. I've tried different treatments and it just didn't. Nothing seemed to really help.
You had the neurostimulator implanted just a few years ago. How have things improved for you since you had the implant?
I can leave the house a lot faster now. Just the taps are off, the switches are off, the garage door is shut. I didn't have to do, I used to do drive-bys, driving around the block just to make sure that the garage door was shut and then having to do it again so nothing bad would happen.
So you can kind of resist that urge to keep checking.
Yes. I can work with the OCD now and not let it overpower me.
Maddie, late last year when you were 15, you had deep brain stimulation for Tourette's syndrome. How did you feel about having a device implanted in your brain?
It was scary, I guess, but then I kind of got used to the fact that I was going to have it. And then it just happened, I guess.
We have some footage of how life looked for you before you had the implant. Let's just have a look at that. Karen, you're Maddie's mum. What was it like for you watching your daughter go through that?
It's something that you can't describe. We'd tried so many different things to help Maddie even just get through a day. Mm. So feeling a massive feeling of helplessness.
Could you even have a conversation with your daughter?
We could, but it would never end well. Mm. So it would always be interrupted or Maddie would, the distraction of her tics would take over.
How did that manifest, say, in the school?
Maddie couldn't go to mainstream school. It came to a point where Maddie was unsafe, smashing glass, doing all sorts of things where Maddie couldn't attend mainstream school. The school tried very, very hard and were very accommodating. It was virtually impossible.
Mm. How did you feel about Maddie having a brain implant?
My husband and I weighed it up in terms of quality of life. So to have the scar and go through such a, you know, big thing for Maddie being 15, or, you know, with the chance of regaining some sort of normal life compared to what she was going through on a daily basis, which was not a pleasant life for her. Once we'd had all the prep work and all of the conversations with the people that we needed to, it made it an easier decision. But right up until she was in surgery, it was very, very full on.
Maddie, did your tics improve after you had the surgery?
100%. Like, I remember thinking when they turned the thing on, I remember thinking, this is not going to work, this is not going to work. And then it absolutely changed my life. Like, tics were 90% gone. I do have my days where some are bad. My seizures are still there, stuff like that. But it's overall life-changing.
Karen, have you noticed a difference?
Unbelievable. In terms of the family dynamic, being able to cope a lot better. Maddie's social interactions are a lot better. So, you know, we're very, very grateful.
Clive, you live on an island off the Queensland coast and these devices need quite regular adjustment. How do you and Peter manage that?
Well, I'm the beneficiary of amazing technology which now makes it remotely possible to adjust the settings on the deep brain stimulants that are going into your head.
So he's kind of on an app, basically, yeah, like on your phone.
That's exactly right.
Peter, so you can be basically anywhere in the world and you can change Clive's brain function?
Yes.
Being able to control patients' symptoms with an app sounds like something from a science fiction movie. What did you think when you heard this was actually possible?
We had a fair discussion about it and thought, no, we've got to do this because there's people in Central Australia, they've got to come into the cities, there's a great burden of care, even if, you know, a half an hour away, someone's got to stop work or bring dad or mum in or vice versa. Mm. It's got, you know, major ethical considerations and we're quite, cognizant of that.
So he's still in control, in a sense, of what you do.
It's the patient is running it and instead of coming in and changing something that is life-changing for them and the family, you can actually do that remotely. That's probably the big thing about it. It's, they're still in charge.
Yes, I still have seizures, but they're just the bad parts of your day. I would never have another piece of technology planted in my brain. I don't think I could ever handle doing it again. I adore where I live. It is a great way to be inspired. My name is Hannah Galvin. I'm 33 years old and I live in Latrobe, Tasmania. I was diagnosed with epilepsy when I was 16. My life just changed that day. I used to have up to 100 seizures a day. I've ended up with a lot of bruising on my legs. I rolled my shoulder out. My brain just wasn't working as well as it should be. I was up for trying anything to get rid of it. I just wanted it gone. I became involved in the epilepsy device trial around 10 years ago. I had a device in my brain that was trying to alert me when I had a seizure. I would constantly have this bright red light going off. That's how my neurologist realized how bad my epilepsy was. I kept getting the red brighter and brighter. I didn't like being constantly reminded of the fact I had that wrong with me. It would just be this annoyance to me always, and I just couldn't handle it. It played with my mind so much. If I had have listened to the device, I would practically just spend my life in hospital. It really affected me, that device, having something in your brain. I didn't want it there. It gave me depression. I had the device removed before the study ended. I was so happy once it was removed from me. It was a very relieving feeling. I love my quiet lifestyle. It's beautiful, it's peaceful, it's stressless, and yes, I still have seizures, but they're just the bad parts of your day. I would never have another piece of technology planted in my brain. I don't think I could ever handle doing it again.
Frederick, you're a bioethicist and you interviewed Hannah for your research into implantable brain devices. What did you discover from Hannah's experience?
We have observed that even if a technology is successful, effective and working perfectly well, there can be psychological rejection.
So psychological rejection is a feeling that you don't have control over your body?
Yeah, there's elements of powerlessness which are associated with what we call a self-estrangement, a sort of a deteriorative moment where you lose control, you have a loss of agency, identity. I can't identify with the control that is taking away from you, for instance.
So it seems like Hannah's body accepted the device, but her mind just couldn't.
Exactly. Her body self-image, for instance, she was quite young when recruited, and I would say that her constitution as an individual or identity wasn't really matching what the device was telling her constantly. Mm. And that has probably led to the rejection. And it's something that we have to learn. Even if we have the most perfect, expensive technologies, it doesn't mean that it will actually match the therapeutic endpoint of a patient in terms of the psychology of living with it.
Gary, you were part of the same trial as Hannah.
I was.
You had to have your device removed when the trial ended. Does Hannah's experience reflect the one you had?
Not at all. I was one of Professor Cook's patients at the time in the trial, and the early results were showing that all of them were having seizures that they didn't know about or didn't realise. And since my seizures are less frequent than most people's, I have them once every 5 to 6 weeks, he asked me whether I'd be willing to participate in the trial, and I eagerly said yes, because I could see the potential benefits.
So the device worked for you?
Well, it worked in that the device collected an enormous amount of data, which was very valuable for the analysis, not only of the seizures that I knew that I was having, but also the seizures which I didn't, which made the interpretation of the data more meaningful. Mm. So in that sense, it worked. The trial was very valuable. Mm. And the fact that it went for 2 years, data collected continuously over that period, 24 hours a day, made the amount of data very valuable.
You've lived with epilepsy for most of your adult life. How does that condition affect you day to day?
The major problem, I think, is not knowing when your next seizure is going to occur. It affects everything that you do and influences your family, your friends and your work colleagues. On one occasion, I was cleaning the pool and I fell and hit my head against the concrete, and next thing I knew, I was in the water, convulsing. And fortunately, my wife ran down and jumped in the water, fully clad, and fished me out. Otherwise, I wouldn't be here.
Mm. So the device basically gave you then an ability to be able to plan around that uncertainty, would that be fair to say?
Certainly. The objective of the trial was to try and identify something that happened in the hour or so before the seizure, so that you could program an app to say, get into bed or stop doing something.
Mark, you're a neurologist who specialises in epilepsy. You led the trial, which Hannah and Gary were in. How did you feel when that trial ended?
Well, it's very disappointing because, unlike a lot of trials which end because they don't work, this was working very well. The problem is perhaps too well for some patients. Mm. So we obtained great insights and were able to show for the first time that it was possible to predict seizures, which people thought was impossible. Mm. So despite being successful, it came to an end which I think was the most disappointing part.
What was it like for the patients to have their devices removed?
Well, some of them wanted them removed. As you heard, Hannah was disappointed with her device. It was very accurate, in fact. It's just that she had no idea how many seizures she was having. And, of course, what we didn't know is how useful this information would be to people. And there were a lot of things that we learned from that. Not everyone wants to be told that they're having seizures all the time, even if it's accurate. Whereas for other people who are having perhaps less frequent seizures, it's of tremendous utility. It's a complicated system, you know, how people respond to the device and what use they make of that information varies a lot from person to person.
Frederick, what has your research found about patients who have had their devices removed?
Well, that it could be extremely traumatic, leading to some, I would say, catastrophic impact on their identity. You can imagine if you are being experiencing epilepsy since you're 4, and at 54 you have this device that suddenly and spectacularly help you to predict it. This is life-changing. It's, as we've heard, the narrative of a miracle. So for that person, it becomes fundamental and essential to this existence. And the day that they have to be explanted, you can imagine how traumatic it is. And to the point that if it is fusional, this new identity is your new life, and suddenly a company that seems to be simply owning some electric things in your body can remove that, you know, agency and identity away from you. So in that respect, it was quite traumatic for that very patient, actually.
In 2010, you were on holidays with friends when your life changed. What happened?
I was on a trip with some friends after completing my freshman year of university, and we were swimming in the ocean, and I hit the sandbar and immediately couldn't feel anything and knew something was mysteriously wrong. The first diagnosis that I had in the hospital was that I broke my neck and had a spinal cord injury, and they told me that I'd be lucky if I was ever able to move my arms again or my shoulders or my hands, let alone be able to walk or really do much with my life.
As part of a medical trial, in 2014, a device was implanted in your brain to restore some movement to your arms. How did the implant work?
This device would essentially understand when I'm thinking about moving my fingers and my hand, and then trigger the correct stimulation to the muscle stimulation system on my forearm to make my hand move, and essentially bypassing my damaged spinal cord.
In August last year, you had to have the device removed. Why?
I did start to have a little bit of an infection around the device, which was a known risk going in. But overall, the device still functioned at the time I had it taken out, which is really exciting to me, you know, to see that it works for 7.5 years. But really just the study was over, unfortunately. After I had the device removed, I didn't have the capability to go into the lab and use the muscle stimulation sleeve and use my hands again. So it was really challenging, to lose that again.
Nanette, how would you feel if you had to have your device removed?
I would be devastated if it was removed. I don't want to go back to how I was before.
Scott, how about you?
I would be quite upset, but, you know, given the circumstances presented to me, I would understand in the end, but we've come such a long way and still have such a long way to go, I would like to keep going.
Clive, how about you?
I think I'd react violently. I can't imagine any kind of scenario that would make it necessary.
Frederick, from what we've heard, merging the brain with technology obviously doesn't always have positive effects. What else have you found in your research?
If we only analyse the narrative of the patient, sometimes they are not in a position to understand the subtleties of how the device actually impact the core of their lives. There's an interesting French study showing that about 55% of people were separating or divorcing following a successful treatment. Again, the device do its job perfectly well, but again, it does not necessarily translate well for the family or the dynamic of the family, or having cases of a patient that suddenly, without symptom, stop working, decides to change their lives, and sometimes it's difficult for them to cope with this.
Tash, you've had deep brain stimulation for Parkinson's. You say it's been effective for your physical symptoms, but that it's come at a mental cost. How?
Don't feel that I'm the same person anymore. And I don't know how you can really describe it, but it's just a feeling of not me.
Did this happen straight after the surgery, a sense that you weren't yourself?
The first 12 months was quite hard because I lived in a rural area, so coming backwards and forwards to have setting changes and things like that. I'm now 6 years in and been told that my neurostimulator is old technology. And I have a lot of highs and lows. And the depression really sets in. I get sick of the struggle because obviously it's progressing in the background. I'm trying really hard to do as much as I can, but yeah, the depression sometimes gets the better of me. And unfortunately, like, I do have had a few attempts. Yeah. And I'm scared that I will succeed, not wanting to, if you can understand.
Tash, what is it like to live with that feeling, that uncertainty?
It's awful, like... but I really try to work hard on my mental health side of things, so I don't get down there. But, yeah, you just can't help it, like, it just happens.
Fiona, you're Tash's sister. This must be a worry for your family.
Absolutely, yep.
How do you manage that?
We'll just be there for her. She knows that I've got the phone. She can call me whenever. I've actually been there when it's after it's happened. The first time was she was in hospital and it took a long time for her to say that she wanted to keep going because she just didn't want to.
She didn't want to be alive.
No. Yep.
Tash, would you still have had the surgery had you known how the implant might affect you?
Yeah, I'll probably have to say yes, because, like, the physical side of me being able to walk properly and move and do things that I couldn't do before has been a huge benefit to me. So I'd have to say yes, but I'd do a lot more homework.
Frederick, have you come across similar situations like this in your research?
Yeah, so it has been tossed as the burden of normality, which was first observed when epileptic patients of having ablative surgery. So the correlation here is that we're doing something with the brain.
It's reversible, though.
Yeah, if you remove,
you just turn it off.
I guess it's more
the effect is reversible, you turn it off. The beauty about many of these technologies we've heard is that they're not permanent. They're reversible, so you're not destroying tissue, which is what used to happen a lot. And because you can actually reverse it, you could test what it's like just turning it down.
Peter, how do you make sure that patients are prepared for changes they might experience when they're living with these devices, the psychological changes?
Well, it depends on the condition. To focus on Parkinson's, there's a process. It's a pre-admission clinic. This is in our centre. I'm not sure whether all centres do this, but you certainly have neurologists, a neurosurgeon, you have a neuropsychiatrist who explores these issues. We have an occupational therapist. We have a rehabilitation person to see what people are like before and afterwards. And therefore, you get a good picture of someone before they embark upon the surgery. And then you have to look at the experience of all the people involved as well. If you've done 10 cases and you do 10 a year, it's not the same as those who do 100 a year. And so everyone has that feel about the patient on the way through. Particularly, we have a neuropsychiatrist, and two of them are excellent, yeah.
Frederick, do you think these sort of ethical considerations are keeping pace with the development of the technology?
Oh, not really. It's hard, actually, because we're talking about cutting-edge science. It's hard to have ethicists admit in our labs. We're very happy when it happens. Here we're lucky where you have invited people to actually consider ethics. We have engineers designing something. It will not necessarily invite the ethicists first to these meetings, right? So, but the necessity is that we're testing with the brain, something as central for someone's identity, sense of the self. I think it will be quite crucial to have ethics involved early, as soon as possible.
And what have you found when it comes to, say, media coverage of these technological advances?
It's pretty alarming. So the overall majority of neuro technologies have been depicted with enthusiastic and overly enthusiastic narratives. So we did conduct a media review, so over 5,000 articles, and only 2.7% of them were addressing the risk and the ethics involved in these experimental trials. So, and that's compared to 76% of these narratives were positive, including talking about enhancements, how that would help humanity to become a better civilization, etc.
Mark, what are your thoughts on the sort of ethical concerns raised by Frederick?
No, well, we've always been very interested in that, hence we involved Frederick in looking at our patients in the study. And it's something we need to understand, but there's a lot we don't understand. I mean, we give many medications which for some people don't work, but for most people do, for instance. And some people for whom it doesn't work get bad reactions, sometimes catastrophic, to even common medications. But that doesn't stop us using them. But we do have to understand it, and we have to talk about it, and we need to have people like Frederick telling us a bit more about it. Mm. We need to speak to the patients and understand what it's like for them.
Penny, what are your thoughts on this?
I think it's difficult to talk about a lot of this technology when, unfortunately, often in the media, it's a two-second bite of information. And there's a lot of nuances in this. There's, you know, a consent process that we go through very thoroughly. There's a psychologist too that has seen all of our seven patients prior to their surgery and ongoing psychological support during the trials. But other press that I've done, people have just really been interested in a really short bite about what's happening.
Jordan, you're a biomedical engineer and inventor working with brain-computer interface technology. Are ethics keeping pace with innovation?
I don't think so. These areas are still really quite new to public discussion. And really, with the pace of change, I mean, we're living at the fastest rate of change we've ever seen. It may also be the slowest rate we'll ever see again. Mm. And this is because of the rate of innovation, the way that innovators now have these pieces of technology. They've got open source code, they've got electronics that can allow them to build their ideas a lot faster than ever before.
When you hear about devices that are implanted in brains, are you concerned at all about sort of hacking or that data being used in different ways?
It's an amazing thing to be able to work in this field, but very much if you're looking at the idea of could these technologies be hacked? Well, like a lot of technologies, you've got to look at how the data is being collected, what sort of data is being collected, what's a hacker going to do with this type of data. These are considerations that need to come into any type of new technological design. What Nick's doing here is he's blinking and he's able to control this game.
Frederick, what are your thoughts on technology like this being, say, commercialised for non-medical use?
Having a device pumping out data out of your brain, it's feeding an artificially intelligent agency that at some point might not need any more humans to be performing actions.
I was always looking over my shoulder thinking, how would these people treat me if they knew that I was trans?
Anytime you have a trans woman athlete in an elite team, well, that's a place that a woman doesn't have.
Well, I am a woman, so I belong there.
Jordan, you've created a prototype which enables the user to play video games using just their mind. How does it work?
This is a tablet PC that can go onto a wheelchair. We work with a lot of friends and families, particularly those who have kids with the high levels of cerebral palsy. Worked with spinal cord injuries, strokes, multiple sclerosis and similar. And what we find is that being able to utilise any of those different abilities that a person has, if we focus on those abilities, we can harness those abilities and turn them into some sort of control. Mm. So what we have here is a device that it's as simple as any sort of brain-computer interface device can get. We've worked on others that are a lot more complicated, can do a lot more things. This is particularly, it's non-invasive. You can see you don't need to have surgery for it. What Nick's doing here is he's blinking, and the blinks are being picked up on by these simple little electrodes here, and he's able to control this game. Now, we made this game because a young friend of ours who is 6 years old, he loves cookies, loves cakes, loves cars, and we decided to work on this. Now, our friend isn't able to control any of his movements and he's non-verbal, but he does have little signals of control, abilities that we harness, like the ability to move his eyebrows or to blink. And so if we can convert that into a simple game, then that's something that can be achieved. We've got communication, music, gaming. We've had a friend drive a real car using a more advanced version of this that we built a while back. They don't need to understand the hardware, but this is forming a bridge between new types of hardware and the people who can build all the apps.
Mm. So how far off do you think we are from having, say, brain implants for non-medical applications.
It really is still early days. Mm. And the breadth of information you can get out of it, a lot of these things are going to be medical related, but if you can do things like play a video game, that can be completely liberating for particularly young people who have never played a video game in their life.
Frederick, what are your thoughts on technology like this being, say, commercialised for non-medical use?
Yeah, it raised question associated with the concept of enhancement. So individuals that would like to increase some of their performances, being smarter or using it at their advantage, it doesn't necessarily mean that as a society we should actually accept these decisions. Again, but at the same time, it doesn't mean that we have to refuse them as well. But also a crucial question that we have to explore is neural rights, because every time that you have your brain having a device pumping out data out of your brain, it's going somewhere on a cloud. This is feeding an algorithm, it's feeding an artificially intelligent agency that at some point might not need any more humans to be performing actions. I don't mean to fall into paranoid meanings here, but the data has to sit somewhere. So yeah, and that could be commercialized, for instance, and we need strict regulation regarding how that will be used in the future.
Nick, you've developed brain implants to help patients living with motor neuron disease. Are there any plans to apply this to some other conditions as well?
Deep brain stimulation has shown that you can put information back into the brain to stop seizures or tremors or a whole range of different conditions. So, you know, there's certainly a bright future, and it's an exciting one. And I think, you know, based on what we've heard, there's certainly a great need in epilepsy, not only the prediction of where the seizures come from, but is there a way that we can, you know, provide stimulation to stop the seizures? Maybe Parkinson's, a lot of these other conditions that have stimulation to suppress or treat that condition. Like you've heard, we're only just understanding what the limitations are, and I'm sure there's going to be a huge amount of neurological conditions that will be treated one way or another, which is exciting and it's fantastic.
Can you see any applications for this beyond medicine?
I think with a lot of medical products, it gets to a point where, you know, if they're safe enough and they're functioning and they're working well enough, then the general population is interested and wants to get involved. And plastic surgery is one of those that started off as a medical application, and you know, it's sort of taken its own pathway now. And I see that some of these bionic devices, certainly, you know, the way they seem to be working in its infancy, you know, they've still got a long way to go, but if they keep on the same trajectory of being safe and being reliable and being able to treat to a whole lot of different conditions, then I'm sure there's going to be uptake.
Peter, you've spent decades delving into the human brain. What part do you think technology will play in future?
Huge. And I think the ethical considerations go with any technology that's developing, be it with medical things or not. You know, humans have got to work out the risks and the benefits and privacy and openness and all these things. But no, I think the technology is going to play a major part in how it works. I mean, we can actually pick up single neurons working in the brain, which you won't be able to pick up externally. And we can see people imagining things, and we can see new neurons come in and then fire off and settle down when people even meditate. We've had Buddhist monks with Parkinson's and things like that. But these things are going to be big, and it is absolutely true that you need to have the ethical things in place. Otherwise, crazy people will take over the space.
Mm. Clive, how is life like for you now?
I can do probably 70% of what someone without Parkinson's in my age group can do. It's life-changing.
Have you changed where you live, what you do?
I've been able to enact a wish that I had from well before I had Parkinson's. I didn't realise this prior to Parkinson's, but I actually had a dream about how I would spend my retirement, which was to live near the sea, to go fishing regularly every day, and to paint and to do artistic things. I'm doing all that.
Nanette, you consider yourself lucky to have kept your brain implant after the clinical trial ended. What are your hopes for other people who are living with OCD?
I hope that the treatment is going to be made available to them and that it's funded by the government because it's so expensive.
So you'd love others to have the same treatment as you?
Yes, it's mind-boggling how much better I am since I've had the deep brain stimulation. It's amazing how it changes you.
Maddie, what have you been able to do since you've had a brain implant to manage your Tourette's?
Okay, so this year I started TAFE, a health course. I've been able to do that with no tics, no worries. And then I've been able to drive. I've got my L's, which has been amazing. And I've made so many friends socially. A shout out to Austin and Tia, they're my best friends. They, all my friends are so nice. And I've been, I just found to do a lot more since I've had this DBS, so it's been great.
Karen, what's it like to sort of see your daughter achieve these things and hear that from her?
Amazing, and I knew that she always had the potential.
Tash, how have you come to terms with keeping the brain implant for your Parkinson's despite those quite negative impacts on your life?
I know I can't function without it because when it gets turned off, I don't function. So, yeah.
So you're making peace with it?
Yeah.
Scott, how do you feel about having a piece of technology living inside your brain?
I personally don't have a problem with it. I can understand how some people would have concerns and issues with it, and I do empathise with Tash for what she goes through. But for me personally, it's a part of me. It's slowly but steadily becoming a very important part of who I am. And because the technology that we're using for the external processing device is upgradable, we are still in the process of developing new functionalities for the device. And I walk into every single testing session with a huge smile on my face and just turn to the guys and say, what's next?
Well, you always love that cyborg idea, right?
Absolutely. I mean, I still wanted to put a little red electrode right in the middle of the lens here just so I could scare people.
Where do you see the bionic eye going in the future?
Oh, look. It could really, really go anywhere. The treatment of my condition, we could develop things that could treat other conditions in the future. And really, the process I'm in at the moment, let's call it phase B. We had the phase A study. I'm in the phase B study. I'm now rolling into the phase C study. And for me, going from B to C is literally moving from old 1960s Star Trek to Star Trek the Next Generation. You know, I'm going, you know, Shatner to Stewart, and I'm losing the hair to prove it.
Thank you so much. That's all we have time for tonight. Thank you so much for sharing your stories, for being involved in this discussion, and for being on the forefront, many of you, of technology. Thank you so much. Thank you for your time. Dateline is next.